morning, church.
Good morning.
Try it with Sim now. Good morning, church.
Good morning.
We love to come together to sing and be a singing church. Let us recognize God's presence with this opening prelude. You're welcome to sing along. Church, we are a people of extravagant welcome, and whenever we get together, we love to say, no matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. You are welcome here, and today, Merdell's going to give our land acknowledgement.
I always think I'm going to break this when I try to get it down to my level, so that might work. Okay, good morning, all. We've made some changes since the bulletin was printed earlier in the week, so hopefully next Sunday you will hear about the Sogoria Te Land Trust. But this morning I'd like to share more of a personal reflection and a land acknowledgement. We are on land that does not belong to us. So that might sound shocking to us, but from a theological perspective, we know that all that we have belongs to God. And long before any of us were here, the land belonged to its caretakers, the native residents who are our indigenous ancestors. I'm convinced that my family benefited from living on land that was stolen from the native inhabitants. My maternal grandmother was born in 1891 and raised in South Dakota. My paternal grandmother was born in 1900 in a Chinese camp. It is a mining camp in the Sierra Nevada foothills near Angels Camp, and they subsequently moved to Grass Valley in Nevada County. My childhood home was in rural Nevada County, and we had Indian grinding rocks literally steps from our back door. So this led to a lot of imaginative play as I gathered acorns and ground them and cooked them into a porridge. Tasted it. Don't try it. So I have always had a remote interest in our native peoples, and when our Tuesday morning book studies began to tackle racism and the injustices, both systemic and personal, that have been inflicted on our sisters and brothers, I began looking into our local history of the land and the people. I've been doing some research to try to piece together some information about the history of the people who were right here, where we live and work and shop and play and worship. So the following information is from Wikipedia, the Pittsburgh Historical Museum, and the Museum of the San Ramon Valley. The indigenous history of our area is not well documented, so much of what we know has come from the California mission records. I'm only passing on what I have learned. There is much more research and verification to be done. And some of the information I've gathered has small inconsistencies, and geographic boundaries are not clearly defined. So most of us have probably heard of the Bay Miwoks. This land was theirs. Documentation of Miwok people dates back as early as 1579 by a priest on a ship under the command of Francis Drake. There were apparently six or seven Bay Miwok-speaking landholding groups in present-day Contra Costa County. The areas and the groups were named by the missions, the present-day city of Pittsburgh, and north across the river to rural South Solano County was home to the Ompans. And that's, and I'm, no, I have not pronounced that correctly, but it's spelled O-M-P-I-N-S. Their center was Collinsville across the river, so that they can, their territory included the small river islands that would have been in between. One source says that the Bay Miwok groups each had 1 to 5 semi-permanent villages and numerous temporary camping sites within a fixed territory of about 6 to 10 miles in diameter. They, along with other native groups, had a dynamic and complex culture with unique language and belief systems. They had an intimate relationship with the land, which they held communally, and tribes owned the right to hunt, fish, gather, and practice their rituals within clearly defined territories, which were often watersheds. They valued their traditional ways and their harmony with nature. Then the Spanish entered California in 1769. They established the missions on traditional tribal lands. Their grazing animals destroyed traditional food-producing vegetation. Their European diseases began decimating the native populations, and they forcefully removed the native people to the Franciscan missions. That began in 1794. The Ompans were among the last to move to the missions. A few went to Mission Dolores in San Francisco. That was in 1810, and most went to Mission San Jose, which is located in present-day Fremont, in 1811 and 1812. Disease and tribal disintegration finally defeated the Ompans. They intermarried with other native groups, and their language was lost. Few babies survived, and diseases such as smallpox, syphilis, measles, and typhus took their toll. When Mexico gained control of California, Mexican ranchos on traditional native lands were granted to former Californio soldiers and others. In 1839, Ompan lands, where we are today, the land was included in an 8,859-acre land grant known as Rancho Los Medanos. The Ompans, as a people, had been erased.
A part of our work as people of faith is telling the truth, even when it's hard to hear. Our announcements this week look like this, and they came in slides. They have reminders of some of our birthdays, Steve Rhodes and Dick Pankey. I don't see them here today, but let's sing to them anyway.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear Steve and Dick. Happy birthday to you.
That's right. We'll be discussing chapter 4 of Rebels, Despots, and Saints. Reverend Shonda was a part of an ancestor weekend that if you sign up, I think you can still see the recordings that she and other scholars have gotten together and done a three-day event on ancestors online. And I think that came in the last e-blast. So if you follow that link, it should get to some of the recordings since it's already over. It would. I think it went Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, but we're going to be discussing Chapter 4 on Tuesday morning, and we'll have our weekly happy hour, social hour, Wednesday at 4 o'clock. So our care team has an announcement, but are there any other announcements that we need to make as a people? Oh, yeah. Why don't you use the microphone then?
Happy Mother's Day to everyone. I want to thank Pat Vines for doing her very best to ventilate the chapel and keep it cooler as much as possible. And for Mother's Day, we'd like each person to take home a cup of geranium flowers. They are supposedly low pollen, a rating of 3 out of 10, but some people might be sensitive to the smell. And so we encourage you to go to fellowship hour after the service down the hall and enjoy the goodies. And there's plenty of cups there, but if you don't go to fellowship hour, there's always some here on the front and the back table. Thank you.
Greetings from your care team. On the 28th of May, which is Pentecost Sunday, we are hosting fellowship hour in an attempt to sort of revive our former barbecue fundraiser. We're not gonna barbecue, we're not quite ready for that, but we are having a nacho bar. We're gonna have nachos with all the fixins for our fellowship time as a part of our only annual fundraiser, which happens to be annually. We are hoping for a $5 donation, but whatever you want to contribute to the care team would be most welcome. We do support our own members when there are times of need. We also support others who are aware of us, who are part of our community. We support food for the hungry. We support winter nights for the homeless. It is a very active outreach, a part of outreach through our care team. We have about 7 members. All of us have a list of our group of people we connect with, people we try to keep informed about what's going on in the church and where they can help if help is needed and where they can come if they need help. So we invite you to support your care team on the 28th or anytime. You're not restricted to only supporting the care team once a year on our fundraiser, but that is a particular one, and we hope that you will continue to support your very active care team. Thank you.
Amen.
Hi, good morning. Just a reminder that our rummage sale is next Saturday. It's not very long, and time just kind of got away, but I need help. It's an all-day or all-week project. People can bring their stuff almost any day this week. We were trying to do some day hours, like from 2 to 4. So I'm trying to get at least 2-hour things, 2 to 4, 4 to 6, and 6 to 8, so that it's a time where everybody can bring what they want to get rid of. And then again on Saturday, I'll need lots of help there, and I have this set up on either 2 or 3 hour slots. So if you can sign up, if you can help at all, please do so. If not, some of the stuff around here that needs fixing won't get fixed.
Amen. It's always invigorating to hear the busy life of the church and how people are participating to do God's work. This is a time in our service when we light our peace candle. And as we light our peace candle this morning, remember that we are lighting it not only here and in our hearts, but also in our community, in our state, in our nation, throughout the world, sending peace to every nation this morning. O God, as we gather this morning to celebrate Mother Earth Day, we honor our connection to you, to the earth, and to each other, We are all part of your mysterious web of life. We pray that you heal places and peoples on earth where the web of life itself has been destroyed by violence. May we stand firm in our resolve to work for justice and peace. May there be peace on earth. Amen.
Amen.
And part of our ritual, as we enter into this solemn, sacred, and joyful moment, is to hear the sound of the singing bowl. Let that sound reverberate in your heart. This too is part of God's mystery.
Thank you, Mike. Good morning. So I have the great privilege of sharing an ancestor story with you today. And I actually brought a picture. This is not someone who is biologically my ancestor, but you might recognize him. His name is Jim Henson. Remember Jim? Jim has a special relationship. Here, I'll pass it around. And a few other Muppets who've been important teachers for us. Here's what I'd like to lift up about Jim today. About vulnerability. He taught me that big feelings are okay. He taught me about diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging when he had people like Ray Charles Green with Kermit the Frog. He also taught me, I grew up in a fairly homogenous town in the Midwest, and David and Maria and Luis and Bob, all of these humans on Sesame Street taught me words in Spanish, taught me about having different colored skin, and all my friends. He was also really great at creative problem solving. Better? It's an antenna issue. We can fix it. So he did this creative problem solving where, like, he figured out how to get a frog to ride a bike. Remember that in the Muppet movie? Or when Miss Piggy did synchronized underwater swimming with all of her other pig friends. And more than anything else, he reminded us that it's so good to be playful and whenever possible to sing. So I want to honor Jim Henson with you all today and to offer some libations as well. So in the African American church, we have retained many African traditions. Among them is libation. So today, as we return water to our earth, let us remember those ancestors who have gone before us, whose memory inspires us to be all that God has claimed us to be. Beloved children and children of peace, please feel free to share the names of your beloved ancestors today as you wish while I offer some water.
Donald Lang, Sr. Anthony McGill. Mm-hmm. Ashe.
Ashe, and blessed be beloved ancestors.
Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
Awesome God, He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God. Awesome God, He reigns from heaven above with wisdom, power, and love. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God. Our God is an awesome God.
Please join me for the call to worship. God's breath stirs the trees in the forest and the traffic lights in the city.
God, we feel your presence.
God's voice speaks in thunder and surf, in poem and concert hall.
God, we feel your presence.
God imagines blooming fields and bustling markets, silent lakes and welcoming meals.
God, we feel your presence.
Please rise.
Dwell in the shelter of the Lord, who will abide in the shadow of the night. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock in whom I trust, and He will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of His hand. The snare of the fowler will never capture you, and famine will bring you no fear. Under His wings your refuge, His faithfulness your shield, and He will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of His hand. You need not fear the terror of the night, nor the arrow that flies by day. Though thousands fall about you, near you it shall not come. And He will raise you up like eagle's wings, bear you on the breath of dawn, make you to shine like the sun, and hold you in the palm of His hand. For to His angels He's given a command to guide you in all of your ways. Upon their hands they will bear you up, let you dash your foot against the stone, and He will raise you up on eagle's wings, bear you on the breath. shine like the sun and hold you in the palm of his hand.
Please join me as we pray together. The God of creation calls us together.
We come to explore matters of the Spirit. There is so much we do not know or understand. So much of God is unknown to us. Let us look carefully at the works of creation,
the intricacies of nature. We want to worship the one who gives us breath. We reach for the reality beyond our knowing. In God we live and move and have our being. All that we have and are comes from God.
Amen.
I am one with the heart of creation. I am one with the heart of God. I am one with the soul of the Spirit. I am one with God. Spirit, I am one with God. Ave Maria, Kyrie eleison.
I am one with the heart of creation. I am one with the heart of love. I am one with the soul of the Spirit. I am one with God.
The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other a sign of Christ's peace.
Lord, listen to your children praying. Lord, send your Spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Listen to your children singing. Lord, send your Spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children singing. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
Please be seated. Our prayer families this week are Marianne Buffo and Elaine Palmer. Grace North Church just had its closing ceremony just last month, which is a big sad day. And Agape Presbyterian Church in San Ramon. And so let's check in with the church at home, see how they're doing, where we have Anne, Bill and Barb, and Chuck, and the Henrys.
Good to see you all.
Continued prayers of healing for Bill.
Praying for wherever those sirens are going, right? Lord, in your mercy. Prayers for Mary. Did anyone get up there to visit Mary this week? Barb's on the line. Do you want to share something?
So I'm sure many of you know Mary is in a care facility in Grass Valley. And if anyone would like to go with her, Barb often goes, usually on a Thursdays. I go, Sherry has gone. So if anyone would like to join us, see either me or Barb. I mean, we're not going every week, but we get up there as often as we can.
Good idea. I'm going to try and get up there soon myself. Joys and concerns we'd like to share. Yeah, Bob. How was your bucket list? We want to hear.
Okay. We had a great time in Canada, except that our railroad was stopped in Jasper, Alberta, because fires were all across and they couldn't.
So already.
So we saw from Vancouver to Jasper both ways, but we didn't get any farther. But we had a great time in Toronto. We were right down in Maple Leaf Square, right next to where the stadium was for the hockey team. And on the same way to the stadium for the baseball game. So when we got off the buses or whatever, we were hit both ways, coming and going. And because our hotel was right there, and we had, in fact, they had a, what was it called? Like a big, big watch party with thousands of people and stuff. And we had to go through that to get to our hotel, but we did it. What I really want to talk about is yesterday was World Trade Day, World Fair Trade Day. And as Christians, we often, even ourselves, look to buy things as easily or as cheaply as we can. And we fail to recognize the efforts of the people who produced the items, the foods, the vegetables, the clothing, whatever. And as Christians, I think we're responsible to make sure that they receive a fair deal, not just us. And so I think we should consider that every time we buy something. Thank you.
Amen, Bob.
So I'm grateful for being back and having the Bell Choir play today and for the safe return from Canada. Want to ask for prayers for Sherry Persing, who broke her foot and couldn't play with us, and hope she heals quickly. And also for a relative who's 15, unmarried and pregnant, and is depressed.
And for all of those that have unwanted or surprise pregnancies that are finding it hard to get the health care they may need in these times too. Lord, in your mercy. Yes. Michael? Then Donald?
Yes, I give thanks this morning for my mother, who turned 90 earlier this year. Most of you heard about that. A joyous occasion. But I also want to give thanks for the mother spirit that nurtures us. I was reminded of that this morning as we were preparing music with the Bell Choir. And I give thanks for Karen, who leads us, and she led us in a nurturing way, a way that symbolizes what a mother can be. So I give thanks for Karen this morning. I also give thanks for each of you who continue to nurture us all with that mother spirit. And that comes in the feminine and the masculine, I might add. So Pastor Will has a a fairly divine mother spirit that he shares with us all on a regular basis. So giving thanks this morning for that spirit that connects us all, that lifts us up, that nurtures us, and that helps us know that we are here and we are loved.
Amen. Lord, hear our prayers.
I give thanks for the scientists that have worked in the laboratory that have just announced day before yesterday a breakthrough for those that are suffering with pancreatic cancer. Wow. God bless them, give them courage and the finances to continue their scientific research.
Especially for what's been considered a death sentence. Lord, in your mercy. Donald?
First of all, I just want to say happy, or I'll, you want to go before me? Or, okay. first of all, I just want to say happy Mother's Day to all the mothers and anybody that's having a mothering spirit. But I also would like to ask for prayers because I don't have my mother right now. And also, I have now two new jobs, one at the Spectrum Center, which is a school with four kids with autism and other challenges, and also for Antioch Unified. I pray for financial stability even before then, and also pray for me because my mental health is kind of up and down sometimes. So just lots of prayers, lots of prayers.
Lord, in your grace.
Pastor Will, I just want to thank all of you because whether you knew or not, I don't know if anybody knew, I had an accident coming from the store whereby I hit the side of the sidewalk there. It tossed me over my cot. I hit the sidewalk and fell and didn't gain consciousness. And they declared me with regard to CPR because they thought I was gone. And that's why I have a special thanks to God today because I'm here. And I'm just so grateful for everyone. And for those of you who didn't know, maybe you thought of me that day, I don't know. But I'm just thankful to be here.
We're grateful to see you.
Thank you.
Lord, in your mercy. Did I miss anybody? Let's pray together. Gracious God, we give you thanks for all of the good gifts in life that you give us, the benefits of food and shelter and caring fellow church members who keep an eye out for us and remind us of your love as we receive that love from each other. Oh God, for all of those for whom this day is a stressor, a day of trauma, a day for whom the experience of mother is not a pleasant thing, we pray especially that you would help them make it through that trauma to be able to be liberated from that. Give them blessed family of choice to be able to be those leaders and servants within their circle to remind them of their full humanity. As we think of all of those places in the world that need your healing touch and those people, conflicts in Pakistan and Gaza, you know all of those places even better than we do, oh God. So we pray that you would be a very real presence of healing in those places as well. As we remember and hear more about what's going on in our own earth and the changing climate and our collective overshoot and overusing the resources on this planet, help us be sure to make sure there are enough resources 7 and 14 and 21 generations into the future, that we may have the long view to make sure that our own use of the resources and even the food that we eat doesn't steal from future generations. Continue to lead us and guide us in the radical prayer that you teach through your son Jesus, and this one based on the Tao from our friend Matthew Fox. We pray with new words this radical prayer Jesus taught his disciples, saying, O Mother of the universe, you dwell in nature, in the sky and in the heavens. Empty yet inexhaustible, you give birth to infinite worlds. You flow through all things, inside and outside. May you give birth through us. Sacred is your unnameable name. Open our hearts like the sky. May each being in the universe return to the common source that is you, and that is serenity. Then, realizing where we come from, earth will be like heaven, and we will become naturally tolerant, disinterested, amused, kind-hearted as a grandmother, dignified as a king. May we, immersed in your order, deal with whatever life brings us, knowing that when death comes, we will be ready. May we heed your teaching that violence, even when well-intentioned, always rebounds on itself. May we learn that our enemies are not demons, but human beings like ourselves. Help us to remain centered in you, so that all things will be in harmony. Then the world would become a paradise. All people would be at peace, and the law would be written in our hearts. As we learn to accomplish the great task by a series of small acts, may we be patient with friends and enemies, compassionate towards ourselves, in order to reconcile all beings in the world. Amen. Enjoy this special video that Reverend Lauren has chosen for us.
Thank you, Julie, so much for the card.
Thank you.
This reading is adapted from Psalm 65. This is how the earth praises God, giving thanks for God's abundance. The meadows clothe themselves with flocks, and the valleys deck themselves with shimmering fields of grain, sharing their bounty with the rest of creation. We too are to worship God by being abundant and fruitful with our lives, offering up our yields as if they were songs of joyful praise. So the first Hebrew scripture reading this morning is from Psalm 139, verses 13 through 16, and it's from the New Revised Standard Version. For it was you who formed my inward parts. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works that I know very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes beheld my unformed substance. In your book were written all the days that were formed for me when none of them as yet existed. And the second Hebrew scripture is from Genesis 3:20, also from the New Revised Standard Version. The man named his wife Eve because she was the mother of all living.
And kindness will follow me I love that. The second reading this morning is entitled, We Have a Beautiful Mother, and it's by Alice Walker. We have a beautiful mother. Her hills are buffaloes. Her buffaloes are hills. We have a beautiful mother. Her oceans are wombs. Her wombs, oceans. We have a beautiful mother. Her teeth, the white stones at the edge of the water. The summer grasses, her plentiful hair. We have a beautiful mother, her green lap immense, her brown embrace eternal, her blue body, everything we know. This is a word of God. All creation is a word of God.
It is so special to be with you all again today. Thank you for having me. So not long ago, my husband and I were in the car at 4:30 in the morning. We were returning home from San Diego and attempting to get ahead of the traffic that would be in Los Angeles. I was driving. To my left was the Pacific Ocean. She was spanning from left to right, and shining from high above was Luna. The full moon was reflecting a steady, kind glow on the water's surface. I was without words. And Valentino, my husband, in his half-asleep state, said, "Isn't it amazing how patient Earth is with us? She's just so gentle." In her 4.5 billion years of being a planet, Earth has known great drama illustrated with superfluous gestures of creativity and supreme acts of destruction. If we used only this as our backdrop for religion, what would our religion consist of? There's this French philosopher and sociologist, Edgar Morin, who has thought a good deal about this question. He describes this deep religion as one that would unite people in both vulnerability and death. Here's what Morin writes. This deep religion would lack any providence, any shining hereafter, but it would bind us together as fellows in unknown adventures. Such a religion would not have promises, but roots. Roots in our cultures, in planetary and human history, roots in life and the stars that have forged the atoms out of which we are made. Roots in the cosmos, where the particles were born and out of which our atoms were made. Such a religion would involve belief, like all religions, but unlike some religions that repress doubt with excessive zeal, this one would make room for doubt within itself. It would look out on the abyss. Driving north that pre-dawn morning, Valentino and I were looking out onto the abyss. Now, as abysses go, it was a safe one, right? We were together, and there was no recognizable or existential threat in that moment. But to see the moon and the ocean in their untamed vastness, it instantly brought us out of our separateness into intimacy with the mystery. We were sharing a moment in the unknown adventure that knows its roots and makes room for doubt. For those few moments, we felt the moon and ocean peering back at us. We beheld them and felt in return the earth's fierce love and grounded equanimity. To be seen this way feels to me a lot like Psalm 139 that we just read. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of earth. Your eyes beheld my unformed substance. Psalm 139 is a very strong teaching in the face of original sin. With careful review of the etymology and translation, original sin might best be described as this spot that's in every single one of us that aches for the cosmic unity we left when we fell from the stars and took form as an embryo. Probably didn't learn that in Sunday school, did we? Simply put, each of us is holding a memory of our eternal home, and we possess this deep longing that cannot be entirely satisfied with what we know in this realm. This original memory and that longing that remains is in each one of us. What is it like to hear this? For me, I feel some heartache, a little fear. It is that abyss that was just mentioned. It is vast, and this insatiable longing that often has us mammals calling out for our moms. Now, in 2016, there was some research. It was on the dolphins. We learned that dolphin mothers sing to their infants while they are in the womb and for some time after, so that the babies can learn their names. Apparently, the rest of the pod quiets their usual sounds during this time to enable the babies to really hear what their moms are singing. Did your mom sing your name? Even when I was a bit too big for the rocking chair still in my room, I can remember prompting my mom, "Rock me?" I was incredibly lucky to be born to the parents I was, and I want to be really clear in this moment on Mother's Day that this day does not mean the same for all people. Our biological or extended relationships do not always match the sentiments in the greeting card aisle or the commercials. But today's art and liturgy has taken us into a deep space of reverence for our mothers. This may be our biological moms, our adopted moms, our symbolic moms, and it is most definitely our great mom, the one described in Genesis 3 as the mother of all living. You know the one. She who beheld our unformed substance even as we were woven in the depths of earth, that mom. Whether or not your biological mom sang your name to you in utero, the mother of all living did. And do you know what? Singing to us still. Singing our names and inviting us to be part of this living religion that does not repress doubt with excessive zeal. The living religion is loving and generous, interdependent, ebbing and flowing. In other words, the doubt is okay. It's the repression that erodes us, the oppression that drowns out the mother's song. So how do we hear the notes again? Honor your mother. It's mentioned a number of times in the Hebrew texts and the New Testament, but what does this instruction mean, really? Yes, we honor her by eating healthy food and composting food waste. We honor her by conserving energy and dismantling systemic injustice. We honor her by voting for climate emergency resolutions. We honor her by repairing painful stories in our families when we can, and by turning off our faucets. We honor her by planting flowers for the pollinators and driving less. We honor her by buying fair trade products and by checking in on the mothers we love and by listening to the next generation. We must do all of this and whatever else is within our capacity too, but honor your mother is not about checking all of these boxes. It's a worldview to become. The religion that honors our mother unites us as beings who see suffering, who recognize death, and who embrace one another, humans and the other than human kin, as peers in this unknown adventure. I don't know a whole lot about dolphins and the vigilance required to stay safe in the open seas. I do know that they travel together, and we've learned this morning that the pods support the young ones in learning their names. Perhaps this is the most important thing, to travel and rest together, to play and eat and look out for one another. And if you become separated or if danger befalls you, to know your name, to carry your mother's song within you so that no matter what, you are always at home. Maybe Jesus, walking in the sands of the Middle East, felt this marine mammal wisdom in his own DNA. Maybe Harriet Tubman could hear the honking of geese pointing her north on those moonless nights. Today, in their distracting and seductive way, modernity and progress have sometimes convinced us that we can avoid vulnerability or that technology can replace the song, can improve the song. But the longing is still there. What can we learn from our non-human relatives about vulnerability and death? Isn't this the rub that all religion is trying to soften? So many sages, mystics, and wise ones have offered words for how we might find more ways to trust death as integral in the unknown adventure. Honoring our mother is about understanding our temporary and eternal essence while looking out on the abyss. We are held. We are named. It cannot be otherwise. Jesus, the Buddha, Lao Tzu, and so many wise teachers and mystics remind us to find our way home by seeing ourselves in all that is living, animate and inanimate. Messages of scarcity and superiority take us down paths of fear and separation. We know we can behave really badly. But that is not the song our mother sings us. The words of her song are medicine, just like the lyrics in Isaiah Barnwell's piece, whose refrain we will sing momentarily. I thought you were gone, but now I know you're with me. You are the voice that whispers all I need to hear. I know that I am you, and you are me, and we are one. I know that who I am is numbered in each grain of sand. I know that I've been blessed over and over again. Beautiful lyrics. We have so much to learn, and evolutionarily speaking, we are barely in elementary school. Honor your mother is about showing up for class and getting quiet enough to hear and being vulnerable enough to be seen and taught by the ones who don't look like us. When we listen, really listen, we honor our mother because we can hear all that lives. It is moving in her, and you and I, we belong, doubts and all. May this be our practice and our religion. In our mother, we are fearfully and wonderfully made, and we cannot ever fall away from our eternal cosmic home. Amen.
I don't know if we know the tune well enough to sing it, but let's at least say those words from that song we heard earlier from Barnwell's Wanting Memories. I am sitting here wanting memories to teach me, to see the beauty in the world through my own eyes. I am sitting here wanting memories to teach me, to see the beauty in the world through my own eyes. Let's have 30 seconds of silence, and then we're going to come back and say it one more time, even like we mean it, even if we don't feel it, to see if saying it like we mean it might help it go deeper into our own hearts. God, you've been conspiring to bring us to this moment for 13.87 billion years. Help us say these words in ways that resonate in our own heart. I am sitting here wanting memories to teach me, to see the beauty in the world through my own eyes. I am sitting here wanting memories to teach me, to see the beauty of the world through my own eyes. Amen.
We aren't yet comfortable enough passing the plates for offering our gifts. So please place your offering in the plate on the table here during the offertory or the closing hymn, or you can place it on the plate in the back table on your way out. If you cannot give in person, we ask that you send all of your offerings online or to me, Merdell, and my address is in our announcements and e-blasts.
Thank you.
O God, these gifts are not truly ours to offer. Everything that is here was first given to us by you. Make us mindful that our possessions all come from your good earth, and that our habits should never render the earth incapable of praising you by the life and bounty it produces. Bless these gifts to the well-being of your world and all of its inhabitants, that we might all praise your holy name. Amen.
Let all things now live
a song of thanksgiving to God our Creator, triumphant we raise, who fashioned and made us, protected and stayed us by guiding us unto the end of our days. God's banners are over us, your light goes before us, a pillar of light shining forth in the night, till shadows have vanished, all fearfulness vanished, as forward we travel from light unto light.
Thy love enforces the stars in their courses, the sun in its orbit obediently shine. The hills and the mountains, the rivers and fountains, the depths of the ocean proclaim God divine. We too should be voicing our love and rejoicing with glad adoration. The song let us raise till all things now living unite in thanksgiving to God in the highest. Hosanna.
Let us send each other forth with these words in our bulletin. We affirm that we are part of a wonderfully mysterious universe, that all life is interrelated in one vast web, that our role lies in nurturing all life and the planet itself, that human beings are genetically one family and of equal value, that every human being has the right to the basic necessities of life, that each of us is on an evolving spiritual journey, and that we are called to work to create a world of justice and peace, compassion and respect.
Go then and delight in the Great Mother. With her love at your back, be a channel of her peace, patience, and fierce love. Please say it with me, Happy Great Mother's Day.
Happy Great Mother's Day.
Go in peace.
Amen.